We can't do that in current
day! She's force-spamming Sokka. The second he gets beat in a fight, or not even beat, but, like, sees her do her fighting, he isn't, like, reluctant or, like, he's just kind of, he essentially just kind of turns tail immediately and is like, she will lead the battalion, and I'm like, why?
Little child, you need to do the main quest. Look at the Joseph Campbell monomyth. Look at the steps. It's right here. You have to do that, or you ain't nothing.
Wanna be a wannabe? Like and subscribe.
And when the world needed the most, they went to talk about the Netflix show.
Avatar, The Last Discourse Bender.
Really, it's bending all sorts of thoughts and minds out here. I'm Gus Zagarella. Welcome to We Are Not Alive.
I'm Addison Peacock. And I am alive for now.
For now. Now, maybe if we talk about this, we may not be alive.
When they hear what I have to say.
We are just wading into that swamp that is discussing the latest reboot of any IP, but especially Avatar The Last Airbender, maybe perhaps the most beloved story of our generation.
One of the most contentious pieces of IP of our generation.
Well, yeah, and I think it's like, you know, there was Lord of the Rings, mm-hmm. and then there was Star Wars. Mm-hmm. And then this is the big monomythic Joseph Campbell and the, like, the legends and the archetypes and all that. That's what it is for us.
It was the first time I learned what shipping was being in middle school and watching Avatar. I was not a Katang shipper. People are gonna be mad at me about that. But that's fine.
It was the show that taught a lot of people how to ship mm-hmm. In the worst way, because it was the ship-teasiest, sleaziest little, like, this show, like, as it, like, went on towards its end, it, like, made sure to torture its audience with the romantic possibilities of the characters.
You cannot call it the ship teasiest when Korra is right there.
Well, that's the thing. Clearly, they didn't have enough of messing with people, of trolling people, of the drama and all that.
Yeah, as, like, a 12-year-old, I was so deep in the Zutara trenches.
I would have been right there with you. We didn't know each other back then, but, like, I was a big Zutara person as well.
Avatar is a beloved show to me. It shaped the way I consume media. It meant a lot to me as a child. It was, like, the first piece of media I watched that was for kids but didn't condescend to them. The thing about it is it also permanently broke some people's brains, because I did log on to Twitter.com today and see someone referring to Aang, the 12-year-old character from Avatar The Last Airbender, as an incel. So I'm just, people don't know how to be normal.
Again, you know, beloved, wonderful, mm-hmm. iconic, I love it, it's perfect, blah,
extremely
blah, blah,
dear to
my
me.
Childhood, yada, yada, yada. It also had the misfortune of all times for it to regain relevant was the pandemic.
Oh, yeah.
Which made it this perfect insanity rabbit hole for a whole new group of people, and also the same people who grew up on it, to just go even more insane and to escape and regress back into their childhood. And again, that is not a knock against the show, which is perfect.
I did a full rewatch of the show. I love the show. I'm like, I cannot emphasize enough. I'm like, I was on the Nickelodeon.com forums writing fan fiction. I asked my mom to, like, break out her old ass sewing machine and make me a Katara dress. I tried to put my hair in the loopies. I was in the pool pretending to waterbend.
One of my early online memories was being on Neopets.com forums.
Hell yeah.
And going to, like, the RP section.
Oh, guys.
And RPing yeah. a waterbender who, like, infiltrated a Fire Nation ship as
yes.
a janitor, who was just a bit too good at cleaning things because he could bend the water. And
yes.
Meanwhile, the other person I was role-playing with was like, you know, I'm Zuko's girlfriend, and Zuko's also a waterbender and an airbender secretly, and I'm an earthbender and a waterbender. And it was like, got out of hand.
I made a Mary Sue OC in the Nickelodeon.com forums and then also in the Neopets forums, who was a waterbender, who specifically was Yue's secret twin sister and was the dark side of the moon. And did shadow bending with water. I don't remember how it worked.
Yes.
I was 12.
To go off of that, I subscribed to Nickelodeon magazine as a kid, which by that I mean my parents knew I was interested in Nickelodeon, and they subscribed for me. I remember there being this like little fan comic at one point that had people's OCs in it, and you did see a shadow bender as well as a cookie dough bender, and it was one of those one of those surreal moments growing up where it was just like, yeah, this show was so powerfully new and different and subversive and adventurous and epic and grand in scale. And it was the Nickelodeon cartoon, the Nicktoon format was buckling to contain what Avatar The Last Airbender was. And I think that's what made it such a groundbreaking show.
Vivid recovered memory of going on DeviantArt again, 12, and singing like a very spicy to me because I was 12 comic of a shirtless Zuko sitting in a pool of water that he turned into a hot tub by doing firebending.
Oh man.
And I was like, this is spicy. I was 12.
Zooey mama.
Yeah.
Anyway, here we are. It's been so many years later. We are now grown adults, and we are staring down the barrel of the Netflix live action adaptation of our childhood. Addison Peacock, how do you feel about that?
It's such a weird beast. This show is such a strange beast because, like, it varies wildly in quality is the weirdest thing about it. Is it varies wildly in quality to me from, like, made me cringe to perfectly serviceable to a couple moments where I was like, good question mark, and then fumbled the bag on a bunch of things, but also did some things that surprised me pleasantly. It's a weird beast. Overall, I'd say it averages out to okay for me. Like, okay, question mark.
I feel a similar way about it. There were parts that I enjoyed. There were things that I was, again, like you said, cringing at. I was like, oh no, please not that.
Please don't do that.
More than anything, I'm glad that this is getting a second season because I can see the potential of this if there's a bit more confidence in the writing room. If certain ideas are developed going forward.
Listen, guys, writers, I know the reviews are pretty mean right now, but I need you to read them, and I need you to look for the parts that are actual good faith criticism, and I need you to go, okay, and I need you to take those, and I need you to use them, because there are some people who mean you harm. There are a lot of people who mean you harm, but there are some people who just want to help you make a good show.
But first, you know, because this is YouTube, and they love the negativity, they love it, the comments are already, you know, they're already, like, full of negativity. I think we'll encourage some of it right now, just to get the elephant in the room out of the way.
No, it's dunk.
I think the handling of the Sokka sexism, every element of the sexist water tribe culture plot.
What did they do? How they massacred my boy.
It was incredibly mishandled. The second episode in particular, something that very much struck me about what they did with Suki and Sokka in this version seemed less like they were trying to make a more progressive piece of media and more like they were doing whatever they needed to do in writing voodoo to avoid putting a man in a dress.
I was just about to say, this is my tinfoil hat moment. I think they were scared of putting Sokka in drag. I think they were scared of people getting mad at them for putting Sokka in drag. That is my tinfoil hat moment.
So, because, yeah, no, literally, they're like, oh, well, we can't have him drag. It'll make people very mad. What do we do instead? Make the line be, I need to be a warrior. I protect and I'm a warrior, and Joseph Campbell and warrior.
We'll get to this. I don't mind some of the characterization choices they made to expand Sokka. I actually earnestly don't mind some of them. Don't get mad at me. Some of them. It is frustrating to see that they've crafted a character that would serve the narrative of being an exploration of toxic masculinity even more in depth. And then they kind of shot themselves directly in the foot and knees. Because it's like, well, you've now built more stuff into him about feeling obligated to be a protector and a warrior and, like, exemplify this model of masculinity presented to him by his father. And it would make sense for that in a 16-year-old boy to manifest in kind of a toxic way. And it's okay for that to happen. It's okay for characters to have rough edges and to have lessons they need to learn. And it feels like across the board, one of the biggest flaws with the writing is them being afraid to let the characters be flawed.
And Katara gets this, I think, the absolute worst.
They flattened her so bad. Yeah.
Did nobody remember that Katara is supposed to be the girl holding up the rock and being like, Earthbenders, the tools of your oppressors can be turned against them. You must rise up and form a great wall, a bulwark against these fascists. We will not let the, you know, I'm paraphrasing.
No, but literally, Katara is such a fucking people. The reason by men on the internet get weird and mad about Katara is that she is like a quintessential, like 14-year-old girl who's just learned about social justice. And that is said with love and compliments to her. I adore her. She's a wonderful character. But she cannot turn it off.
No, exactly. And that's what's so compelling about her in the original. But it also leads to some pretty bad cognitive dissonance. Again, not just with those men, but all people who liked women growing up, that if their politics leaned a different way and Katara was their first fictional crush, it leads to this bizarre, you know, pathologizing of what she's supposed to be.
Because she's like also the mom friend, as we talked about off mic, she's like the mom friend. So it also, I think there are people who view her as being like a scold because she's like, literally nothing will happen if I'm not here to be like, please, we have to do stuff. Boys, please listen to me.
This aspect of her, like the social justice, the constant talking about, like, you know, how to save the world and how to do things right and, you know, pull together and sappy speeches and all that. That was how the character was viewed back in the day. I don't want any revisionist history because the Ember Island players' portrayal of Katara had to come from somewhere.
Yeah, the Ember Island players' version of her is that she's crying all the time and giving big speeches about hope. That's her hold up. And to be fair, and here's the thing, this is the meanest thing I might say the whole video, the characterizations of Katara specifically in the show are like Ember Island Katara.
And you know why that is because she has no rage in her. She has no fight in her.
She's not angry.
She is just this, like, I'm a nice girl and I just want to save the world because I'm so nice. And
she's got no bite.
Early on, because Sokka would, in the original cartoon, treat her very sexistly, you know, kind of belittle her. In this, they really don't have, like, anything to fight about, so she really just feels like Sokka's sister.
Related to that, Sokka, my boy, I got really frustrated because this actor wants to be funny so bad. Like, and I mean that he is funny. Like, naturally, I think the actor playing Sokka is quite funny.
But the script refuses! The script says no!
So, like, every so often, they would let him say something funny, and his delivery would, like, accidentally just take me out. I'm like, this kid's fucking funny. And they won't let him be funny.
No, they that's the thing. I think, and I know this is a, you know, a kind of ubiquitous, everyone says this about everything nowadays. It's the big talking point. But I do think that the writing here is sometimes the weakest element because it results in moments where the actors themselves are giving performances that are restrained by the words that they have to say.
Yes. And here's the thing. I really hoped earnestly when this show was first announced that they would take lessons from the Netflix One Piece because Netflix One Piece is a banger. Netflix One Piece goes hard.
It rocks.
The thing that rules about Netflix One Piece is that it is completely unselfconscious. It is not embarrassed by the anime bullshit that it has to do and has in its world inherently. Like, Luffy is stretchy. Get it, get in or get out. Like, get on board or this isn't your show. Like, meet Buggy the Clown. He can make himself a bunch of pieces. His head landed in a lady's lap and he did a little wink at her. It's cheeky. It's weird. It's anime. Their phones are snails. You have to be okay with this. And it feels like the Avatar writing team was scared of that. It feels like they didn't want to do the, like, get cool with it or get out thing. It feels like they were more like trying to have their cake and eat it too, where it's like having elements of it that are the cartoony kind of fun, but then trying to, like, appeal to people who look down on cartoons and cartoonish storytelling. And it's like, honestly, dude, this show was never going to be for those people. Those people were never going to be fans of this.
Yeah, I don't want to, like, I think it's pretty cringe to, like, read into the intentions of creative people, like behind the scenes, unless they specifically say anything in interviews. But I do think that this project smacks of, we were really into Avatar, but we really want people to know that we saw it as the cool, deep, mature show on Nickelodeon, rather than the goofy, silly, cringe one.
Gus, you're not reading too much into that because one of the writers said they wanted it to feel like Game of Thrones for kids.
Which feels as, like, ill-conceived a statement as when a certain mysterious Mr. Enter said that he wanted his show to be BoJack Horseman for kids. That doesn't really take.
You can't really do that.
There is a place and a time where a darker tone can, and in some cases does, work in this show, but I'd argue in a very specific way, it has to be that Aang is this character who comes from a pure utopian, idealized past that contrasts with the dark, complicated, chaotic present day.
Exactly! Like, there's no contrast. He's very serious. He's a very... And listen, like, part of Aang's character is the contrast of him being a 12-year-old boy with all that comes with, and being, you know, the Avatar and having to wrestle with that burden, a burden that terrifies him. But I'm going to tell you something that made me extra sad about this is I saw some behind the scenes footage of the little boy that plays Aang just like running around and goofing off and like fucking around. And he is so adorable and like high energy. And he is so Aang-like when he's freed from the shackles of the writing.
No, it's true. And there are like brief glimpses of that throughout this, throughout the runtime. It's just, it's one of the things where like, I think a major kind of problem with the first episode.
First episode is the weakest of the bunch, too. Like, let's go ahead and put that out there.
It's true. It's a bad first impression. And fitting in a lot of stuff, you're left with this weird moment where Aang describes a first act of this that didn't happen, where he's like, well, you know my character. I'm a fun-loving guy who loves my food and loves my lemurs, and I'm not ready for these big city responsibilities. And it's like, this is an editing issue. Like, that line should have been cut.
That happens a couple times where there's a line, there's like a Katara line about Sokka, and she's like, do you ever not think with your stomach? And I'm like, I would have loved to see that. I would have liked to see that. I didn't see that happen. This is, I have more negatives to highlight first, but I do want to give a compliment sandwich too, because the actor who plays Sokka I actually quite really liked. Not only because he just looks exactly like the cartoon, which is really surreal to me. Like, I was looking at him multiple scenes and just being like, he has the same nose and the same face. Anyway, but he is really good at seeing a girl and reminding the audience that he has never seen a teenage girl, like a girl his own age he wasn't related to before, like right now.
It's true.
He's so just he like, saw whoa. Suki and I, yeah, he sees Suki for the first time. I saw his brain explode.
Man is flabbergasted.
He is down bad immediately. Like, he looked at UA and I could hear the like, boy, yo, 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 yo,
whoa!
I'm like, that's pretty good. And I really, like, people are maybe going to have different takes, but I think this actor has really good instincts and really understands Sokka. And I think that the writing doesn't always share his understanding of the character. Like, that's the vibe that I got, because he is so...
Whenever they let him, like, scream or exclaim, you're like, that's a Sokka. That's a 100% a water tribe man.
There he is. No, literally, he's got a couple moments in the show, and I wish I'd written them down as I watched it, but there were a few specific moments where I, like, out loud was like, well, there he is.
Yeah. Also, can we just talk about, I'm inviting the demons in by beginning any kind of compliment, but I think it's really cool how Aang and Sokka feel like they have a closer friendship from the get-go based on their experiences in this version. Because there's two moments in the first episode where, like, Aang sacrifices himself, he gets captured by the Fire Nation, and before leaving, he says to Sokka, I think you're the bravest person I ever met. And then, when Appa rescues Aang, you know, Sokka grabs his hand, and Aang is, like, delighted, and he's like, Sokka! And I'm like, oh my goodness, this is different from the original, but like, that's a decently established friendship between these two men.
I think they've given these boys a sweet friendship. I actually agree with that. I think, I wish that they could, that's the thing that hurts me about a lot of the things that they do in this that are changes that I like.
It's at the expense of the women.
Yes!
It's at the expense of, well, let's put Katara as on the bench as to not offend the sensibilities of the modern woke spotter.
Literally. I was gonna say, it's at the expense of something that I love. Every time there's a cool new thing I like, something I love, the monkey's paw curls one finger in, and something I love is taken out of the show. Like, they took out, like Suki is still a cool enough character, I think, but she's a different character. That's not her. She's a different person. Like, that's not Suki, that's a different girl. They put a girl in it who's a warrior and is neat, and I like her, but she's not the same character even a little bit. And I was like, well, that's sad. Honestly, also, they robbed me of some primo ship bait, which is they could have shown me her putting Sokka in the makeup, and that would have been extremely cute and extremely charged.
We can't have that. We can't do that in current day.
She's force-bending Sokka.
We can't do it. Honestly, a lot of this does come down to the kind of playing it safe you see in, like, really big budget reimaginings of older things, which, like, especially in the case of Avatar The Last Airbender, being way more progressive than anything else at the time in terms of that stuff, to the point that, like, I don't know if too many people know this, but one of Jet's freedom fighters, Smellerby, is actually, like, widely interpreted as being a trans character.
Oh, hell yeah. That
rules. In the original, there's a very telling moment where Iroh appears to misgender her, and then she, you know, has this, like, side conversation with Longshot about, like, how she shouldn't care about other people's perceptions, and it, you know, as long as she believes in who she is, it's fine. And that doesn't really go into anything else. That doesn't become a plot point or anything. It's just there so you know who this character is and how she's formed her identity. And that's something that, despite Smellerby in the new version being played by a non-binary actor, we don't get any indication of that.
Well, honestly, in general, it's like a show that has a lot to say about gender and gender roles. And again, that's why I'm very, very annoyed by the sort of kneecapping of the Water Tribe sexism storyline. Really didn't like how they handled it at the North either.
It's very like this one old guy gets owned by facts and logic because the rest of society has already moved on.
Yeah, the systemic sexism goes away so easily. And I'm like, okay.
It doesn't like actually authentically feel like systemic sexism. Like, it feels instead like, instead of there being like a patriarchy in the North Pole, it feels like Paku is this weird guy who they all kind of tolerate because he's like okay at waterbending.
He's just like weird sexist grandpa.
Yeah, like, and it's one of those things where like Katara like says like, oh, they've been isolated so long, they've been frozen in time, like, which implies to me that unlike the original series, we are not currently going through a period of sexism. Sexism is like de facto treated as a bizarre, aberrant philosophy of the past.
Yep, that's the thing about its take on sexism, is they're like, no one does sexism anymore. This is an old-timey thing that doesn't happen anymore. And yeah. It's like, and him very quickly, the second he gets beat in a fight, or not even beat, but like sees her do her fighting, he isn't like reluctant or like, he's just kind of, he essentially just kind of turns tail immediately and is like, she will lead the battalion. And I'm like, why?
Well, that's the even dumber part, is that you get that moment where Katara is like, there are a bunch of women not fighting. If we have more women, we have bigger number. Bigger number, beat, defeat enemy. And Paku goes, but my irrational biases. And then he looks at the crowd of like stone-faced women ready to do the greatest waterbending of all time, on par with waterbenders who have been training in the combat ways. And then the healer woman walks up to him and goes, you old fogey, let's get him out there. Let's show him who's boss. And he goes, oh, darn it. Oh, and everybody clapped. Reddit moment. Wholesome chungus. It fucking sucked.
You know what would have been earnestly really cool?
Yeah.
I think is if all the women came and found Katara after the fight with him and were like, can you show us how to do that?
And then, that's how she becomes a master, by teaching other women. But see, here's the thing. Then we'd need a show willing to actually pursue the agency of its female characters to the extent of the original.
We'd need a show that wants to write Katara the way, yeah, that she, with as much like active agency as she has in the original.
Where the fuck is Antifa Katara? I'm sorry, that's uncomfortable.
Where is SJW Katara?
Where is Katara wearing a hoodie that says social justice waterbender on it?
Whither art thou? My social justice Katara. I love you, girl.
Why is she not waterbending waterbending, dyeing her hair blue, blue like the element that she controls. She's so powerful.
She's got blue hair and pronouns.
She's got so many. She can bend all the pronouns. You don't. This is getting silly. This is verging wildly into fanfic territory. We're like half a second from a Miku Binder appearing.
I was just about to say we're approaching Miku Binder Jefferson territory.
Okay.
I have to. There are some other things I didn't like I have to talk about before I can talk about things that I liked. I have to dunk.
We gotta dunk. We gotta dunk. The internet demands the more dunking. We gotta dunk.
They took Appa's personality away. He doesn't do stuff. He's just there. And he... Where is his personality?
He is a big magic carpet that floats along the earth and takes them from episode to episode. Mm-hmm. And there's also Momo, who has the character traits of sometimes exist and die.
He didn't stay dead. At least Momo and Sokka were gathering fruit together in that one shot. That was cute. I would have liked more of that.
Yeah. Well, that again, it's one of those things where it's like Aang can't hang out with his animal buddies. He is too busy being jump scared by every powerful adult from the past.
They made him so serious. They made him so serious all the time.
Can I just say, again, to fold this into something that I would actually... It fascinates me and interests me about this take on the mythos is that if Aang were more of a pure, fun, innocent boy who was like always kind of like happy and silly and innocent and naive, it would make it all the more interesting that each time we see a past avatar, they are an angry god, like declaring, like by divine mandate, that Aang needs to get his shit together and do the fucking main quest. Little child, you need to do the main quest. Look at the Joseph Campbell monomyth. Look at the steps. It's right here. You have to do that or you ain't nothing.
No, genuinely. I would love to see that contrast.
I would love to see the contrast. Instead, I am just left with the honestly kind of interesting idea that all of these avatars are like, I mean, they're dead people. They're angry ghosts. They literally wish that they had agency over the world. But for one reason or another, like, all they talk about is their own failures and follies. And they're asking, like begging Aang to not be like them. Like, Kyoshi is like, you gotta get your power in check. I got too much power.
Yeah, the funny thing is that's something I really don't mind. I quite liked that, but the contrast is what's missing to make that work.
Yeah, no. That's the thing. I like that they are doing the avatars like this. I think it's fresh. I think it's new. I think it's interesting.
I like that Roku's got jokes.
Roku's an odd one in this version because he's very like, yeah,
he's got jokes.
All my friends left me. I'm sad. Anyway, would you like this fucking Funko Pop that can help defeat Go the Face Stealer?
Would you like this quest item?
Would you like this magical talisman? Would you like this Yorble, this fucking Jiggy from Banjo-Kazooie? Like, stupid.
I'm gonna tell you my biggest complaint of the entire fucking show.
Oh, lay it on us. Lay it on us, Addison.
They neutered the Ko the Face Stealer scene so hard. Like,
he doesn't even have his main thing.
Like, they took his main attribute away, which is if you talk to him, you have to maintain a neutral expression or he will take your face. That is so scary. When I was a kid, it scared the shit out of me. And when I watched the scene, I would try really hard to keep a neutral face and be like, would I be able to get through this scene without making a face and getting my face took? And I was waiting for him to receive that explanation from Roku or anything. But instead, we just got a scene where Aang interacted with Ko and didn't make any big facial expressions for seemingly no reason.
Yeah, like, instead, like, Ko the Face Stealer, it seems like he just takes your face if you hang out in his zone for too long.
If you make him mad, he takes your face.
All right, that's it, Buster. Takes your face.
He's like, all right, fuck you. Unfaces your face.
And again, Roku is just like, I took this statue of his mom. He really doesn't like that I took his mom from him.
Like, why did he need to have a mom and a special statue? Why could he simply not be an exposition dump that is very scary? And if you look at him and you make an expression, he will take your face.
Yeah, like, I don't know why we need fucking little Daedric figurines in this.
What was the point? What was the reason? I have one other one that's just because it made me crazy, and I know more people are going to bring this up. In the last episode, Yue uses waterbending to ice Sokka's feet to the ground before she does her self-sacrificing moment. Here's the thing about that. The moon was dead at that point, so how'd she do a waterbending?
Oh no, what? Oh my god!
How can she do waterbending when the moon is dead?
I think we gotta look a little bit more closely at the storyboards, you guys.
Yeah, I'm not a Ding 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 CinemaSins plot hole person, but I'm like, that's a very big story point at this exact moment. The whole reason she's doing her walk into the water and give her life to the moon spirit thing is because waterbending is gone right now because the moon spirit died. So she can't do that.
Ayeesh, yowza, that's, ooh,
she can't
boy.
Do a waterbending when the moon spirit is dead, you guys. That's, like, the whole thing.
If anyone tries to, like, be, like, a Star Wars fan and turn this into, like, a force kick situation, where, like, you know, that shot of, like, Luke, like, that shot from, like, the wrong side, where he kicks someone who's 5 feet away and they take their lumps, but the editors didn't catch it in Return of the Jedi. If anyone tries to be like, oh, well, Yue has, you know, special ocean bending that lets it... Fuck off. Don't. Just don't. Just... They made a mistake. It's okay.
Yeah.
They made a mistake. It happens. I watched Nickelodeon as a kid. I saw them in that one shot have a green Wanda from Fairly Odd Parents and a pink Cosmo. It's fine. These things happen, you know?
No, exactly. It's just that one. That one particularly took me out. I'm like, there's a lot of grace I will give that took me out. I'm like, girl, you can't do that right now. The moon is dead.
I think that it's moments like those where, like, you know, we have to be reminded that, like, yeah, it is artificial, and they can totally fuck this up. You can't try to, you know, holistically look at something as completely flawless. But yeah, that's a pretty rough one, where I'm sure that they had the freezing of the feet happen just to make it a little bit more like, but what if Sokka with big strong man soldier, big warrior man, makes her not do it? And it's like, well, what if he just kind of respects her decision? What if, like, the original?
I was gonna say, could it not have been more powerful if she instead used her words to convince him not to stop her? Anyway, it's funny because they did some stuff with Yue that I liked. The little, like, ice cream thing was very sweet.
Yeah, I also thought it was interesting that in this version, Yue just pops over to the spirit world. She's a VTuber. She just becomes a fox.
Oh, that was insane. I didn't care for the, why is she a fox? That was weird. Didn't care for that. Didn't like that.
What I didn't get is that not only can she do that, she was acting all, like, coy about it to Sokka. Like, oh, you know, you don't know that I'm secretly a fox and we've met before. It's like, why? What the?
Oh, he knows she's a fox. Boy, yo, yo, yo. Anyway.
Also the weird stuff with, like, her current fiance where, like, they couldn't have an actual, like love rival. They couldn't make him, like, a jerk or anything.
Again, like, literally,
what was that?
The defanging of the characters. It's, they didn't want it to, they're scared to make Sokka look bad, earnestly, because it looks, they're like, oh, it makes him too complicated and bad if he's pursuing a girl who is engaged to somebody.
Yeah.
I'm like, earnestly, I'm like, they're afraid to let Sokka be flawed. I'm like, it's okay, actually, if he has a thing for a girl who's in an arranged marriage. It really is okay.
Yeah, but then they'd have to make, what's his face, the former fiance, they'd have to make him kind of a jerk to, like, underscore how much of, like, a patriarchal, like, nightmare that the water...
He wouldn't even have to be a jerk. They could keep the characterization. If they really wanted to keep him being a nice guy, they could keep him basically being, like, I can tell she doesn't feel the way about me the way I do about her. Like, I would marry her even if it wasn't arranged, but she doesn't seem to think that way or whatever. Like, you could do that if you want. It's not really going to take it away. If you make it clear that she's not in love with the guy, then I think you're fine. But, like...
Yeah, also she, like, she makes a self-sacrificial gesture and dies. Like, you know, having split romantic interests is not, like, a sin. That, like, and again, even if it is, like, you know, a sin that, like, oh, you know, the incels would get really mad about, like, you know, this two-timing woman or whatever, she literally dies. That's all they want from a woman.
She
is
does.
That if she ever
she
does
turns
anything
into the
wrong,
moon.
She dies. She,
so
makes
she
a big
will be punished by the narrative.
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
I really like Amber Midthunder. I think she did some really nice stuff with Yue, given what she was given. I liked the more extensive parallels they drew between, like, both of them feeling bound by duty while they just want to be kids. But, and that's my compliment sandwich, because I didn't like the fox thing, and I didn't, and they messed up with the ice thing, and they're so scared to make Sokka be flawed.
The fact that they're being bound by duty, and this being a thing across most of the characters, not Katara, she's not really a character.
They don't let her do shit!
This theme, like, I know it doesn't appear at this point in the story, because again, this was like silly season one, where it was still trying to figure out whether it was a Nickelodeon cartoon or like the greatest fantasy serialized show of its time. But this theme of characters being bound by duty and overwhelmed by the powerful who wish to instill their power through them and act through them, this is the theme of the last four episodes of the original series. You just don't recognize it in this form because it's been implemented so quickly.
Exactly. They're rushing some stuff.
I think it's something that, if handled well, makes do we kill the Fire Lord question, it makes it a lot more compelling if that is the main theme of the story. Like, this kind of, like, does your duty outweigh your humanity?
And outweigh your personal values.
Yeah, and I think that is what Avatar The Last Airbender ends on. It's the note, it's the final, like, sort of, like, you know, philosophical conflict of the show. So to seed that early on and to make that kind of a prevailing theme is doing justice to making this a new take on the series. And I think it's, whether or not that's accidental or they're going to continue to develop that, I think there's potential in that seed of a thing to make Avatar, in the same way that One Piece live action was, more itself from the beginning. It's all about striking a balance.
At the end of the day, like, I think the reason I don't get upset about adaptations the way that I used to is that is that contrary to what discourse on the internet will have you believe, the original doesn't stop existing.
It's right there, you guys. It's on the same streaming service. It's right there.
And what I earnestly hope is, I hope people will try out the live action and be like, I don't know, maybe I'll see what the original thing was all about, because, like, I don't know. It's sort of like how all the shitty adaptations of The Picture of Dorian Gray made me read the book The Picture of Dorian Gray. I don't know how to describe, like, put this into words exactly, except that, like, I don't consider even bad adaptations to be inherently a bad thing when they can funnel people toward the best version of the thing.
There is this kind of bizarre sense of, like, people holding this new thing to the standards of something that is, like, unimpeachably good without realizing that, like, they couldn't just do it again.
There's no point in adaptation if you just make the thing but make it again.
Yeah, literally just rewatch the original at that point.
Also, the live action show is pulling a lot of its choices tonally and stylistically. People are going to get mad at me for this, maybe, but a lot of the choices it's making that I don't like, I agree with you, I don't like them, are not coming from thin air. They're coming from the comics.
Oh, no!
They are, though. The comics do a lot of this, like, really serious, like, over-the-top, like, stuff. Like, a lot of some of the tonal stuff, I feel like I never enjoyed the comics when I was younger, and I think part of it's because they felt so different and sometimes felt like out of character.
The promise is very weird. It's a very weird continuation of the original story. There's parts of it I like, though.
No, 100%. That's not me saying they're all the way bad. It's just, I'm like, my point is, this is hardly the first time, and it won't be the last, that, like, this world has had adaptations. In fact, actually, I'm going to go ahead and point this out, and people are going to get mad at me. I'm sorry, but there hasn't been a follow-up to Avatar that hasn't made people mad. The original series people love. A lot of people are divided about Korra. A lot of people are divided about the comics. People universally hated the M. Night Shyamalan movie, and we're not going to do revisionism. We're not doing M. Night Shyamalan The Last Airbender revisionism in 2024.
I think it's entirely fair to say that, like, between Avatar, the original, being the best thing ever in many people's minds,
it was lightning in the bottle.
And the M. Night Shyamalan movie being the worst thing ever in a lot of people's mind, not just as an adaptation, but, like, as a film, like, as a big budget.
Like, it's not a good movie.
I think that it is very important that we treat this thing as somewhere in the middle of that spectrum. as somewhere between the best in the universe that ever existed and the literal worst in the entire universe. Can we treat this as in the middle?
And I say this as someone who fucking loves Avatar. I love it so much. I love the show so much. I think folks are deliberately like putting their blinders on and forgetting the parts that didn't work, like the episodes that were kind of clunkers, or like the jokes that are written very like for children who watch Nickelodeon cartoons. Like there's a lot of like, he's right behind me, isn't he, kind of style jokes in original season one of Avatar. And I feel like everyone's put their blinders on because I saw someone complaining about the joke in Avatar where Sokka's like, no way, I'm not getting on that. And then cut to him screaming on the back of Appa and people are like, this is so cringe. And I'm like, I think they've done this joke exactly in the original cartoon. It's not like...
I don't think people know how much that there were like awkward moments in season one that would be punctuated with like a literal comical cough from a silent crowd.
Wharp, wharp, wharp.
Or just moment, yeah, sound design where it was like beep, boop. Like that sound effect to indicate that something really awkward and cringe has happened, you guys.
I do wish they'd kept the guy on Kyoshi who foams at the mouth and collapses to the ground.
He's the real Cabbage Man. Though the fact that it's the actual guy.
I think it's nice that it's the voice actor. I think it's neat and it's sweet because he's a voice actor who really elevated a very small, like, one-off character. And I think it's sweet that he got to come back. I liked that. I know it's pandering. I liked it. I thought it was sweet.
Also, one thing I will say, in the Omashu arc, overall, you know, there's some odd mixtures of different characters. I think they do some more justice than others. They do the Mad King Bumi very differently in the live action.
I liked him a lot.
Yes, I agree. I liked him a lot in this version. Don't get me wrong. I love our funny, memeable Nickelodeon man. This tricky, wild old guy who says goofy things and talks about, oh, the newly refurbished chamber. Not the old chamber, not the good chamber. Kangaroo Island, it's pretty hopping over that. He would not survive the dialogue people of today. Like, they would burn him at the stake for some of the wacky, crazy, wild things he would say.
I have to note that they let him do puns.
More than they let him do puns, they took Bumi in a wildly interesting new direction.
I liked it.
I will defend, and I know that's a strong word, because it adds to the fact, like, the previously dead avatars, they're going to be angry, they're going to be all about duty. Bumi is a physical, living entity in the world who, unlike these past avatars, has experienced 100 years of this war. We saw the kid he was, and we saw the man that this made him. And in a Nickelodeon show for kids, especially on the 6th episode of something that isn't sure that it's going to be super, super serious, you have to make him a little bit of a goofy guy. But recontextualizing him, making him a symbol of the 100-year war and the childhood and life that, like, Aang left behind, but is still kind of arrested in, it's powerful.
I like that he's kind of bitter. I liked that he was bitter.
Bumi, for me, he is one of the major highlights of this first season, and I'm interested to see what they do with him and Booker.
Also think it's really delightful, earnestly. I'm like, that one of the only things they get from the cartoon is they're always like, don't worry, he's still gonna be weirdly jacked for an old man.
He's buff as fuck, boy.
He's still gonna be weirdly jacked for an old man and have like big crazy tufts of armpit hair.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, hell yeah, let's go. And that brings us actually to the part of the video that hopefully all the people who are going to get really mad at me have already clicked off by now, because now I get to talk about the stuff I thought was good. You're going to notice a theme pretty fast with the stuff I thought was good, because almost all of it has to do with the Fire Nation.
Yeah, yeah.
All of it that I have left has to do with the Fire Nation.
The Fire Nation was on some other shit in this adaptation.
That was giving me visions, like, of what the show could have been. It was giving me, like, visions of if they had kept this Fire Nation, but let Team Avatar be silly and flawed and more close to their original selves, because I fucking liked, I rocked with the shit they did with these. Iroh was perfect. Everybody fucking, I think even people who have hated this show have been able to be like, okay, this man is a very good Iroh. He's wonderful.
He's so good.
He's so wonderful. What a lovely performance. He looks just like him. His bond, like his chemistry with the actor who plays Zuko, is so lovely. Like, he's so sweet. He's incredible at the like single tear of stoicism spilling over. I'm like, oh my god, this man. He made me cry multiple times. I loved him. If I have to hear him sing Leaves from the Vine while singing about his dead son, I'm gonna lose my shit.
Forget about it. Oh my god. The Zuko and Iroh relationship is so well done in this.
It's good. Complain to your mom. I don't want to hear it.
I think that the like Game of Thrones comparisons, like you were saying, they should not apply to our regular, like, you know, Avatar kids, like the Team Avatar. Mm-hmm. But I think they begin and end non-pejoratively in the Fire Nation with all of this scheming and strategizing and unpacking the complexity of like Iroh being this very like conscientious old man with a deep connection to his like family and loved ones and these losses that he's trying to overcome, but also he was a monster.
They took all the nuance away from Team Avatar and they gave it to the Fire Nation characters, and I love seeing it in them, but I'm like, why did it have to be taken to be given?
Addison, there was a thought that I had while watching like the later episodes of this as this went on, and I was like, oh, okay, this is like the new play that the Ember Island players put on like 20 years after the war, where they were very self-effacing and very like unpacking their historical baggage. This feels like the story of Avatar: The Last Airbender as told by a self-effacing post-fascism Fire Nation.
You're so fucking right. The thing is, so I actually really, talking about things I liked, I really liked that scene with Iroh having to face the soldier who lost his brother at the siege of Ba Sing Se.
That's powerful shit.
I liked that scene a lot. I like, in general, the kind of Game of Thronesification of the Fire Nation characters specifically. I think people underestimate how hard it is to sell certain kind of villainous tropes in a live action format. I saw people having really harsh critiques of this characterization of Ozai, because there's the scene where he deliberately praises Zuko's efforts to look for the Avatar to sort of goad Azula into doing something. And people were like, he would never do that, even to get Azula to do something. And I'm like, I get that. I hear the criticism. However, I do not dislike this version of Ozai. I like this version of him. I like giving him some more subtlety. I think there's something to be said for giving him some subtlety. He's still very much evil. They're not beating around the bush about the fact that he's fucking evil. But like, I don't think there's anything wrong with him being a bit more, like, us seeing him pit his kids against each other and us seeing him plant these seeds of resentment and, like, there can only be one in his daughter. Like, I don't mind seeing that. I don't mind seeing where that came from.
In my eyes, I don't think it makes him, like, less ruthless. I think it makes him a more convincing manipulator, someone who is more, like, obviously trying to forge his children into the weapons of his nation that will succeed him.
Yes, I think he seems like a more real abusive parent, is what he seems like
to
me.
Yeah, because the actual dynamic of I'm an evil parent and one of my children is perfectly evil too, that doesn't happen. You have to make that child that way.
I like seeing her become that way.
It makes me think of One Piece live action, much better, well done show in terms of its execution, but there were a lot of early criticisms with the character of Garp and the way that he was changed in the adaptation and given a subplot. People were like, oh, he's so antagonistic, he's so much more goofy and, like, you know, laid back in the comic and in the anime. I think what the show, what One Piece was doing is showing him get to that point of being a little bit more accepting, of unclenching his iron fist a little bit, because, like, a man in Garp's position, realistically, the live-action version of it, where the actor has to, like, you know, portray that, has to have the face and body language, does need to be a little bit less cartoonish and a little bit more true to where they are, authentically. And I think the same is happening with Ozai. It's just people are a lot more precious about Ozai because he is not a, like, side character in a huge, sprawling cast. He is the main villain of the entire show.
Yes. I think Daniel Dae Kim plays him very well. I think he's very intimidating and very frightening. And I like this young lady who plays Azula. I like her so much. It's weird to make the criticism. I've seen a little bit of this. The criticism that she's not evil enough when we first meet her. Because I'm like, the first thing we see her do is pretend that she's like a refugee so she can ingratiate herself with a group of revolutionaries and then have them all immolated in front of her.
Yeah, like she is doing evil, evil shit. Like, just because she is not like doing like, you know, Nickelodeon appropriate edgy speeches about how she's going to throw people overboard. Again, not a knock against the real show. The real show is flawless and perfect. But what I'm saying is, in terms of evil, in terms of actual harm that she's doing, she is doing it.
Oh God, yeah, she's fucked up. This is also part of why her characterization had to change, is because they changed Katara's characterization. Because Azula is, to me, in the original show, a foil to Katara. And with Katara lacking the same flaws she has in the original show, she cannot be a foil to Azula. So they have instead made Azula a foil to Zuko. I think because of that, they have to be like, this is what this pressure and these expectations and this pitting of each other against each other has done to this child and to the other child. These are the two directions it can go. I really liked that they made Zuko a bit more obviously naive, too. He's so shocked by the idea that Fire Nation soldiers would use dishonorable war tactics. He's so shocked by the idea that his father would lie to him. Again, it felt very real to me. Like, obviously he suffered greatly at the hands of his father, but that's also his father, and he also has to believe in the nation that he's from and in his father as a good man. Otherwise there's nothing to want to go back to. He has to want to go back, and for him to want to go back, he needs to believe in these people and to believe in this place. And so I think that a lot of stuff this actor did and a lot of stuff they did with Zuko's characterization, I really liked. I thought it worked very well.
And to go off, like, you know, the original stuff, like, he had this rivalry with Zhao, which is transferred over into this throughout the whole first season, but he didn't really cotton on to the fact that, like, his father really didn't want him home, and that his sister was out, like, actually out to get him until the beginning of the second season. So for anyone to expect Zuko to be, like, aware of that in season one, they are the ones projecting their knowledge of having seen the whole story onto this new version of it.
He's a very angry young man, but he is actually quite naive in a lot of ways. And I really loved this actor letting some of that in. He's still very angry. He's very pissed. Also, he had certain line deliveries that took me out and I thought were extremely precious and like really good reminders of the fact that, like, God, these characters are so young. His delivery of, like, when he's, like, tearing his room apart and he's, like, pissed because he's had his first ever encounter with the Avatar and he expected this grand battle, but the Avatar just ran away and he's, like, throwing all his stuff around. He's, like, I can't find my fucking notebook. And Iroh's, like, checks on him, and Zuko, like, with a teenage boy voice crack is, like, he ran! And I'm, like, that's so... He's 16!
Okay, another thing that I absolutely dig about the Fire Nation is that I think that they got the costume design so good. The look of, like, the soldiers.
I think the costuming in general looks so sick.
And again, you know, the like, let's help Azula beat the she's not evil enough allegations. When she shows up at the, like, end of the season with, like, wearing the Firebender helmet, and like pulling King Bumi in chains as she stands there and goes like, Omashu is ours. We didn't see that in the original. We saw her, like, you know, preen and, like, order, like, bully people who were, like, beneath her around. But, like, to see Azula being like, our nation triumphant, we have brought this city to its knees. Here is Bumi, the, like, earth, one of the greatest earthbenders in the world. I know he's not trying neutral Jang, blah, 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 who cares. Down to his knees in front of her. And she's just like, yeah, rah, rah, Fire Nation, we're the best, I'm the best, I'm my father's perfect child, I am the Sun Warrior, I am Azula.
She sold it to me. I like her. I like this girl. She sold it. She's giving child prodigy.
Including Azula at all was a big departure from the first season, but I think it will benefit in the long run if they, like, start from this place and they make her get even more evil as the story goes on.
Which is why we see a slightly different, I think, Azula than we're used to. It makes sense to me. She's already a fucking evil little bitch at the beginning of it, but, like, watching her go from, like, a little more disorganized and, like, still having these very childlike outbursts and stuff to at the end of the season being that kind of cold, calculated leader, like, that, like, military, like, she's a human weapon,
Like, I'm sorry. We've already seen the hyper-competent, voiced by a veteran voice actress, animated so that her expression can always be as cartoonishly stoic or manipulative or whatever the animator wants it to be, because that's the strength of animation, as possible. Give us what was condensed in the last couple episodes of the show, this, like, madness, the fall of, like, Fire Lord Azula. Make that her entire arc throughout this show, and you have a very interesting new take on the character of this descent into total madness and turning her into a real monster.
I want to see this little girl get darker and crueler and, like, meaner. I want to see it because I think this actress is really fantastic. And they did the one thing that this show disappointed me in a lot of ways. In a lot of ways, we've talked about all of them pretty much. But one thing I said from the get-go when they cast this actress who plays Azula is that she has a very, like, sweet, naturally kind of sweet-looking face. She has, like, round cheeks and, like, big eyes. And I was like, I feel like they're going to use that to their advantage because there's something unsettling about a face that looks that sweet, like, saying and doing the things that Azula does. And to me, I think that this actress uses that to her advantage.
Yeah, no, and I think it will be interesting to see, like, you know, some of the iconic moments throughout the series. I think that, like, obviously she took a backseat to Zhao, but given the extent to which they were able to characterize Zhao and make some of his big moments matter.
I liked Zhao's characterization.
I loved the added scene of him talking about how much the Fire Nation is awesome and how they're going to, like, celebrate. Like it is insane to me how much the Firebenders love their nation and feel like they feel like genuine fascists because they revel of how good their nation is. Obviously there's this underlying level of violence and you know, coercion, but they no longer feel like the Nickelodeon Team Rocket squad that they were in the early season.
Also, I like that they made him feel a little bit more believably sneaky. Like, it makes sense to me that, like, people wouldn't suspect Zhao of having secret evil plans. I'm like, and I love the cartoon, but in the cartoon, because it is for a very young audience, he is, like, telegraphing that he has an evil secret.
It's true. And that works for the audience that it was aimed at. Being the book one audience of Avatar The Last Airbender, the Nickelodeon season.
But it is okay that this guy who plays Zhao in the live action is a little bit more like, oh no, Prince Zuko, I would love to work with you, Prince Zuko. It's great to work together, don't you think, Prince Zuko? And then secretly being like, hey, Azula, your fucking stupid brother is here. I'm gonna, yeah. I'm like, gonna get him.
I like the note of Zhao being a minor commander from the South Seas, which is looked on, like, with derision by some of these other people. Because, yeah, like, look what's in that region. Kyoshi Island, that is, like, isolationist and has never gotten involved in the war. The Southern Water Tribe, which they already fucked, like, generations ago. The fact that he is, like, a social-climbing, enterprising person who's trying to use his pursuit of the Avatar to gain that status, it's very believable, and it shows the hierarchy that the Fire Nation the Fire Nation rules. It's the Fire Nation rules!
It rules, and it lends an extra bit of oomph to his, like, desperation to, like, do something that a lot of, like, more respectable long-term Fire Nation leaders like Iroh would think, like, find horrific. Like, him being willing to, like, kill the Moon Spirit, he's like, there's a desperation to him, there's that clawing to the top. It was good. I loved having correct Iroh characterization for him to be like, whatever you do to that spirit, I'm gonna do to you tenfold. Like,
yeah, he did say the line, I think he said it a little too early because the fish was still in the pond at that point, but, like,
yeah,
but the spirit was there.
But he was like, he knew he was gonna hurt he was gonna kill it. I did love, also I loved that actor's fucking delivery of, like, basically something, I'm paraphrasing, but he was like, I'm not insane, I'm not going to kill the moon, like, I'm not gonna kill the moon and the ocean spirits, that's insane.
Yeah,
I'm just gonna kill the moon.
It is. One thing I love about all versions of Zhao the character, and this includes the M. Night Shyamalan version of Zhao, bizarrely enough, because he has this one line in it which kind of sums up the essence of his character, is that in the M. Night Shyamalan version, Asif Manvi, who is playing Zhao for some inexplicable reason.
Wild casting.
Yeah, he stabs the fish and he goes, we are gods now.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah, brother.
That, to me, is the essence of Admiral Zhao, is that he's a guy who is so willing to climb the ladder that he skips all the rungs up until God.
Yeah, Zhao the Moonslayer.
Yeah, he will become a legend, remember, for, and that's why I think his cameo in Korra is so emblematic and perfect of the writer still understanding the character by having him be this loser wandering in the mists.
Oh yeah, he's in the mists of lost souls. His fatal flaw is hubris. I also liked, last thing about Fire Nation, I liked getting some extra flashbacks about Iroh grieving Lutan. I liked the fact that Iroh felt naturally protective of Zuko from the very beginning because Zuko was the only person to demonstrate softness and compassion to him when he lost his son. This is going to sound wild, but you're going to know what I mean, I think. Seeing flashbacks of Zuko where we get to see bits of him being very, like, having kind of a very naturally gentle spirit in spite of everything he's been taught shows me, like, the thing that that Ozai saw in him that he wanted to stamp out. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, precisely.
What Ozai looked at and went, like, hell, I'm going to let my fucking son be like that. Like, him giving the little thing to Iroh at the funeral, like, that very tender, like, exchange, when he knows he's not supposed to do that. He knows he's supposed to just be like, it was glorious that he died for the Fire Nation, and it's an honor to you. And he's like, actually, I know this is very sad. I thought your son was a good friend to me, and I'm sorry, uncle. I'm like, that's fucking, there he is. That's the soft heart that Zuko's worked hard to crush and hide and harden over and solidify into stone. And that is the soft heart that eventually Aang is going to chip away and get back to.
And I will say this too. Like, I know, you know, there's a ton of people out there who are still like, this is a fake version of the show. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, which is fine.
You know, this version of events is a bizarre Elseworld.
I would honestly prefer they do that than act like it like somehow makes the original go away. So like...
Oh, yeah. Like, there's a sliding scale of like takes on this. But I think it is important to point out that in this version, we get something that was completely absent from the original, which I think is neat to see in some form, and that's Iroh and Ozai having any on-screen interaction.
Yes, because they're brothers.
It literally never happened. They are like, in the original, they're brothers in the same way that, like, the Flynn brothers from the Kitchen Booth movie are brothers.
That's a wild thing to say. We never see them interact. I think that's the reason I don't get as angry. I get frustrated with creative choices that I don't understand why you'd make them. I get really frustrated with, like, the neutering of characters that I care about. I do. But I think I feel a level of, like, distance and an ability to appreciate things that they do that I like because this show doesn't feel, like, real to me. I don't know how to explain this. It feels like I'm just watching, like, a fan film, and I'm like, what an interesting reinterpretation of the events. I wouldn't have done it like that. But I also like this other thing you did. I don't know. I feel like I'm looking at fan art. I don't know how else to describe it.
No. To be fair, I mean, it is, like, this show is more than likely, from what we've seen, it was made by people who feel like, you know, both scared and overjoyed to be in the position of being the people who tell the Avatar story again. Like, they're fans, too, of this, so it is effectively a fan fiction.
I think they beefed it in a lot of ways, but I also think there are parts where that love comes through, and it's interesting to see the parts where that love comes through.
Okay, hot. Blue firebending, scalding, scalding take coming in.
Okay, go.
Are you ready?
I'm so scared.
I think seeing this final product and knowing that Bryke, I'm going to use their fandom name for the original writers of the show, the writers of this, the original, the writers of Korra, the fact that they walked away from this project comes across as an act of creative cowardice. And I'm going to explain why.
Please explain, because that's a very hot take.
It's the hottest take, and it is probably the thing that will make people most mad at me, but hear me out. Mm-hmm. I think that in this era where we've got Netflix is doing, you know, One Piece live action, where Eiichiro Oda chipped in, made a very different story based on his new reinterpretations of what should be in kind of a second draft of it, what would be in the live action version, what would make for a faithful to the spirit, if not faithful to the letter, adaptation. You have shit like
Scott Pilgrim Takes Off,
which I love. Which Brian Lee O'Malley came back to.
He did.
He took his own story and made something new out of it, which showed, you know, a love and appreciation for these characters that has evolved over time, that has matured, and has created a, you know, a worthy entry into the oeuvre of his previous Scott Pilgrim work. You have even shit like He-Man and the Masters of the Universe, Revelations and Revolution, which, although Kevin Smith was not involved in the actual He-Man, he is effectively, I don't think he's a great filmmaker, but it's hard to argue that he's not nerd royalty.
No, 100%.
Yeah, like, going in to do some He-Man stuff from love and a desire to make people aware of how awesome it was, what he saw in it as a child, even if that means changing things.
May I present a counterpoint? Because you mentioned before that you don't like to guess the creative motivations, right?
Not generally.
We have no real way of knowing that this walk away choice wasn't because they were frustrated by some of the unrisk taking that we've been so frustrated by in this version of the story.
Well, here's the thing though, and I'm going to push back on your counterpoint.
Okay, let's go. Counterpoint.
They are the guys, right?
Yes.
They're sitting there in the room, and what are, like the writers are happy to be working with them, most definitely, mm-hmm. right? And Netflix, you know, has them back. They've got all this Avatar stuff planned, and they, you know, there is this feeling to me that, like, yeah, Netflix would ask for some, like, you know, play it safe stuff, but for a lot of these previous projects that I mentioned just now, that play the safe stuff is less apparent, and the reason is that the creators behind each of these projects had a definitive vision so impressed upon the team that mm-hmm. it had to be done. And when you're the guys, people are gonna fucking listen to you. But maybe, you know, it's been several years since Korra, which was already, you know, I love Korra, but, you know, it's a mixed reception show. Maybe, given the fact that, like, even Aaron Ehas, who is the golden child of the internet in terms of, like, you know, people talking about, like, you know, who made the original Avatar, his Dragon Prince stuff, it's certainly not as celebrated as Avatar, I'll give it that much.
Yeah, nobody really watched it.
These guys were there, Brike were there in the room, and I feel strongly, I spiritually think they just don't have the imagination.
Whoa.
They had a chance. They had a chance to make this lukewarm kind of mid retelling of their story into something bold and into something interesting. And when they walked away, the chance of this being amazing went with them.
Now that I agree with. I cannot, where you go, I cannot follow to a certain extent because I just don't feel comfortable.
You don't have to follow. You can be the reasonable person in this.
Okay.
To my, like, total insane, like conspiracy theory tinfoil hat take.
Okay, because I will wave to you from across. You might say, Gus, we're standing on opposite sides of some sort of great divide.
Yeah. Oh, this is the great divide. The great divide in the fandom, the great divide in our minds, the great divide in our hearts.
Can I bring us home with just one thing?
Yes.
I was really glad that they still let that guy sing his little secret tunnel song.
Yeah. It's true. It's
secret
true.
Tunnel.
I'm happy with
secret
that.
Tunnel.
Secret tunnel.
Through the mountains.
In conclusion, I think, you know, when you take one of the greatest stories of all time and you make a noticeably less good version of it, it doesn't become the worst thing in the world. It becomes slightly better than any Star Wars piece of media ever released.
Holy
okay, bye!
Shit.
Bye!